growing up in Port Allen. Here it is. I grew up on Court Street, and on one side of Court Street, the black people lived. On the other side of Court Street, the white people lived. This is how I looked growing up as a kid, this little brown, curly-haired kid with big teeth and big ears.
I lived through desegregation in the 1960s and experienced racism growing up in the South, but I know it was nothing compared to what my ancestors endured. I just never got to learn their histories.
I don't know where this journey is going to take me. What am I doing? Are you rolling? I couldn't do this without my mother, and I can't tell you how excited I am that she is going to be with me. Hey, mother.
Hi. I had no idea at all where my ancestors were from. I did have an idea that I did have ancestors in Africa, but I never, ever thought about pursuing it. And she was riding around in her little car.
My mom is my best friend now. My grandmother was my best friend then. She was just this beautiful, regal woman who we all loved, and I mean, she was a matriarch of the family.
My mother, she had problems with people. She was shunned because of her color. And her father was white.
Michelle Erkenbrack from Ancestry.com has been researching my roots.
One of the things that we found in Don's tree, his great-grandparents were a white man and a black woman who worked at a place called Sinclair Plantation in Brulee, Louisiana.
Sinclair Plantation, built in 1855, where my great-grandmother, Catherine Jackson, worked at the sugarcane mill, and where my great-grandfather, Harry Revo, was the plantation overseer or manager.
Was it this hot when I was a kid here?
Yeah.
Hotter?
We are walking along what is known as Manager's Row. So anyone that worked at the plantation had housing provided to them, and these are those houses.
I remember the smells of burnt sugarcane in the hot summer air, but I didn't know I had a connection to this place.
So who lived on this row?
Harry. Wasn't there a story about Harry and Mary Henrietta?
Well, it's a story my mom told me, that her mother died in childbirth, and Harry Revo wanted to take her and raise her, but her grandparents chose not to do that. So they came and got her and raised her.
And it makes you wonder how that could have changed and affected her life. It would have been the difference between having been raised in a white family or in a black family. Harry Revo. This is him in 1910. He's also living in West Baton Rouge, and Odile is his wife. And him and Odile never had any children.
Really?
They never had children.
He died at 56?
Mm-hmm. The cause of death is right here.
Gunshot wound of the head.
His suicide was in the papers.
Mr. Revo, who had been in ill health for several months, killed himself Saturday by placing a 12-gauge pump gun to his head and pulling the trigger. The coroner's jury brought in a verdict of suicide.
But why would he kill himself? What was going on in his life?
Maybe not having a relationship with his child, and he never had children, and that was the only child, and she was black.
I wish I had asked my grandmother what she knew about her father, or how much he tried to be a part of her life.
Who bought the house?
He did, for my mom.
He bought it and gave it to her,
mm-hmm.
Right? This is someone that he cares for and is trying to provide for in his own way, because you didn't know that he had done that, right?
No, I never knew that. My mom said she saved the money to buy it.
Mm.
And she never worked, so we wondered how she saved the money.
Sure, she had her ways, right?
She had her ways. Ways.
That's a family thing.
Ways.
Turns out that my family has lived and labored in this area since before the Civil War. Our roots date back to when Louisiana first became part of America in 1803.
For the next part of your story, we are coming here to the West Baton Rouge Museum. this cabin was taken from the Allendale plantation and was built by slaves. So we're in a building that's very contemporary to the time of when your ancestors lived here as well. I want to shift back over to Catherine Woods, your third great-grandmother. Now, we don't know who her father was, but there's a candidate. His name was Clemens Woods.
Black male, 68.
He was born in Louisiana, and his father was born
Africa.
Africa. So Clemens represents that first generation that was born in the States, and his father represents one of the last generations to come directly from Africa. The next question is, where in Africa do you think he might have been from?
I am confronted with the question, who do I think I am? It's something only my ancestral DNA could show.
So these are your results. 76% African and 22% European. And then you've got 25% Nigeria and 22% Cameroon and Congo. 50% of your genetic makeup comes from that specific region in Africa.
Wow.
My ancestry is deeply rooted in what is now known as the Slave Coast. My mom and I traveled to Ghana's Cape Coast Castle, the main exit point for slaves coming to the United States.
Esso?
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
Nice meeting you.
This is my mother, Catherine.
Hi, mom.
Hi,
you're warmly welcome.
So why are we here?
So we're going to take a tour. I'm going to take you back in time. This was a male slave dungeon. This was constructed in around 1792. It was designed for 1,000 people.
In here?
Yes.
Can you imagine being this dungeon?
They stayed here for about 3 months on the average.
What, in
this darkness, yes.
It felt like a descent into hell. I felt like this must be what it's like to enter hell. I couldn't believe that people walked down that path and then walked through here and then spent months in here, if you survived.
This was a dungeon for the troublemakers, those who were inciting rebellions and instigating violence.
But it was dark in here.
It was dark in here, right? They were held here in chains. So you see the hole on the wall? The holes on the wall. They were held in chains. And this channel served as a drainage for their feces and urine. The floor on which you are standing now has been excavated. It's made up of feces, blood, decomposed bodies, clothes, food, vomit, sweats, and perhaps the tears of the occupants of the dungeon.
I kept looking for places to escape, and there was no escape. The only escape was either become a slave, go to a new world, or you escape through death.
What we are standing before now is a shrine. And behind this wall, there was a tunnel through which the captives were led to the exits.
Is that where the ships
were? To get on the ships.
Yes, to get on the boats and into the ships. Now, the walls have been dedicated to the souls of our ancestors.
I don't know how many thousands or millions of people ended up in places like this.
I've actually requested for a candle for you to light in memory of ancestors who passed through this facility.
That one little candle was a fire of inspiration.
We're survivors.
Yes.
Survivor spirit. Survivors.
Door of no return. Through this door, they left behind the known for the unknown. They left behind security for insecurity. We're going to go through this door.
You want to go? And then you walk through, not the passage you came in, but then through another passage, through the door of no return, and then onto a ship, away from your family,
And then who knows what happened to you after that.
Right onto the ship.
In 1998, two bodies of ex-slaves were exhumed in America and Jamaica. They were brought back through this door to reverse the trend of no return.
I was thinking there, I just can't hold it in anymore. Then I wake up every day, my life is like a dream. Every day I feel like I'm dreaming. I have such a wonderful life. I am so blessed and so fortunate. I want all those people who think that they can't survive and all those people who say, well, I can't do this, I can't do that. I want to show people that that isn't true. You can do whatever you want.
So on behalf of the government and people of this country, it's my pleasure to welcome you back.
Who do I think I am? I know that I'm a survivor, and I came from a group of people who are survivors. Why wouldn't I want to do the best that I could to honor those people?